I rise to present the budget for the year 2020-2021. Sir, in May 2019, Prime Minister Modi received a massive mandate to form the government again. With renewed vigour, under his leadership, we commit ourselves to serve the people of India with all humility and dedication. People of India have unequivocally given their janadesh for not just political stability and also reposed faith in our economic policy. This is the budget to boost their incomes and enhance their purchasing power. Only through higher growth we can achieve that and have our youth gainfully and meaningfully employed. Let our businesses be innovative, healthy and solvent with use of technology. For today's youth born at the turn of the century, for every member of the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes who seek a better life, for every woman wishing to stand up and get counted, for every individual from the minority sections of our society, this budget aims to give and have your aspirations and hopes addressed. We wish to open up vistas for a vibrant and dynamic economy with a gentle breeze of new technology. This vibrant India shall be a caring society which shall attend to its weak, the old and the vulnerable among its citizens. During 2014-19, our government brought in a paradigm shift in governance. This shift was characterized by a twin focus: fundamental structural reform and inclusive growth. Fundamentals of the economy are strong, and that has ensured macroeconomic stability. Inflation has been well contained. Banks saw a thorough cleaning up of accumulated loans of the past decade, and then they were recapitalized. Companies were provided an exit through the IBC. Several steps on the formalization of the economy were taken up. Of the structural reforms, the goods and services tax, the GST, has been the most historic in our country. Its chief architect is not with us today. I pay homage to the visionary leader, late Sri Arun Jaitley. At the time of rollout of GST, he had said, and I quote, It will be an India where the center and states will work harmoniously towards the common goal of shared prosperity. The unanimity of the constitutional amendment and the consensus of the GST Council highlights that India can rise above narrow politics for the nation's interest. With the GST, neither the state nor the center loses its sovereignty. In contrast, they will pool their sovereignty on decisions on indirect taxes, unquote. True to this vision for the historic structural reform, the goods and services tax has been gradually maturing into a tax that has integrated the country economically. It has consolidated numerous taxes and cesses to one tax and facilitated formalization of the economy. It has resulted in the efficiency gains in logistic and transport sectors. The turnaround time for trucks has witnessed a substantial reduction to the tune of 20% due to abolition of checkposts in the GST. The dreaded Inspector Raj has also vanished. It has also led to a significant benefit to MSME by way of enhanced threshold and composition limit. The effective tax incidence on almost every commodity came down substantially. Through several rate reductions, an annual benefit of 1 lakh crore rupees has been extended to consumers. It amounts to 10% reduction in overall tax incidence. An average household now saves about 4% of its monthly spends on account of reduced GST rates. During this phase of maturing, GST did face certain challenges. This was natural, as transition was daunting. GST Council has been proactive in resolving issues during the transition. In the last 2 years, we have added more than 60 lakh new taxpayers. A total of about 40 crore returns were filed. 800 crore invoices were uploaded, and 105 crore e-way bills were generated. There has been extensive engagement with stakeholders. A simplified new return system is being introduced from 1st April 2020. A former Prime Minister had once voiced a concern that the fruits of the welfare schemes were not reaching the intended citizens. The common and deserving citizen was only receiving 15 paise of every rupee sent to him. Guided by Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, Sabka Vishwas, our government and our Prime Minister added manifold speed and scaled up the implementation of schemes and programs that directly benefited the poor and the disadvantaged. I wish to list out only a few as examples. One, welfare schemes with direct benefit transfer embedded in them. Two, sanitation and water as provision of basic needs and as a measure of preventive health care. Three, health care through Ayushman Bharat, clean energy through Ujjwala and solar power. Fourth, fifth, financial inclusion, credit support, insurance protection to vulnerable sections and pension scheme. Fifth, sixth, digital penetration with broadband and UPI. And finally, affordable housing for all through PMAY, the Prime Minister Awas Yojana. The milestones achieved are unprecedented, globally recognized, and benchmarked against international indices. This strategy changed the established order of a few individuals, cornering most of the benefits, and was appreciated by the people. This had immensely positive outcomes. We have moved on from a growth rate of just over 4% in 1950s to 6% in 80s and in the 90s. However, during 2014 and 19, we clocked a growth of 7.4% on average, with inflation averaging around 4.5% itself. It is worthwhile to note that inflation was close to 9% in the last 2 decades of the last millennium, and ranged 10.5% during 2009 and 14. Between 2006 and 2016, India was able to raise, I repeat that line, between 2006 and 16, India was able to raise 271 million people out of poverty, which we all should be proud of. Got elevated to the level of $284 billion during 2014 and 19, from $190 billion that came in during the years 2009 to 14. The central government debt that has been the bane of our economy got reduced in March 2019. to 48.7% of GDP from a level of 52.2% in March 2014. Just between 14 and 19, I recall this figure, the central government's debt in March 2019 has come down to 48.7% of the GDP from a level of 52.2% in March 2014. With this backdrop, our government shall work towards taking the country forward so that we can leapfrog to the next level of health, prosperity, and well-being. We shall strive to bring ease of living to every citizen. I am mindful of presenting this budget in the backdrop of two cross-cutting developments. One, proliferation of technologies, especially analytics, machine learning, robotics, bioinformatics, and artificial intelligence. And also, number two, the number of people in the productive age group, that is 15 to 65 years of age in India, being at its highest. So these are the two cross-cutting streams, keeping in the backdrop while we are talking about the budget today. This combination is special to contemporary India. Across the world, if there is a shrinking of globalization, equally, there is a debate on the efficacy of monetary policy too. The efforts we have made in the last 5 years and the energy, the enthusiasm, and the innovation of our youth are the ignition required to push forward. This Indian spirit of entrepreneurship, which weathered several storms over the centuries, inspire and motivate us. We recognize the need to support and further energize the spirit. This budget is woven around three prominent themes. One, aspirational India, in which all sections of the society seek better standards of living with access to health, education, and better jobs. Two, economic development for all, indicated in the Prime Minister's exhortation of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, Sabka Vishwas. This would entail reforms across swathes of the economy. Simultaneously, it would mean yielding more space for the private sector. Together, they would ensure higher productivity and greater efficiency. And three, ours shall be a caring society that is both humane and compassionate. Antyodaya is an article of faith. So, I repeat, this budget is woven around three prominent themes: aspirational India, economic development, and a caring society. The digital revolution, which has placed India in a unique leadership position globally, will see the next wave. We shall aim to achieve seamless delivery of services through digital governance, to improve physical quality of life through national infrastructure pipeline, risk mitigation through disaster resilience, social security through pension and insurance penetration. Each one of these initiatives and their components would be benchmarked to international standards, and the indices would be announced soon. Before I move to elaborate on each of these three themes, I wish to recite a small verse in Kashmiri. Son Watan, Gulzar Shalimar Hyun. Son Watan, Gulzar Shalimar Hyun. Dal Man's Folwoon, Pamposh Hyun. Navjavan An Hund, Vushan Kumar Hyun. Myonu Vatan, Chyonu Vatan, Sonu Vatan, Nundboni Vatan.